Random House Audio presents Nature Girl by Carl Hiaasen. Read for you by Jane Curtin. On the second day of January, winds swept and bright. A half-blood Seminole named Sammy Tigertail dumped a dead body in the Lostman's River. The water temperature was 59 degrees, too nippy for sharks or alligators. But maybe not for crabs, thought Sammy Tigertail. Watching the corpse sink, he pondered the foolishness of white men. This one had called himself Wilson when he arrived on the Big Cypress Reservation, reeking of alcohol and demanding an airboat ride. He spoke of ringing in the New Year at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, which was owned by the Seminole tribe on 86 acres between Miami and Fort Lauderdale. Wilson told Sammy Tigertail that he'd been sorely disappointed not to find a single Indian at the casino, and that after a full night of drinking, hot babes, and seven cards stud, he'd driven all the way out to Big Cypress just to get himself photographed with a genuine Seminole.
"Some dumbass bet me $100 I couldn't find one," Wilson said, slinging a flabby arm around Sammy Tigertail. "But here you are, brother. Hey, where can I buy one of them cardboard cameras?"
Sammy Tigertail directed Wilson toward a convenience store. The man returned with a throwaway Kodak, a bag of beef jerky, and a six-pack. Mercifully, the airboat engine was so loud that it drowned out most of Wilson's life story. Sammy Tigertail heard enough to learn that the man was from the greater Milwaukee area, and that for a living he sold trolling motors to walleye fishermen. 10 minutes into the ride, Wilson's cheeks turned pink from the chill, and his bloodshot eyes started leaking, and his shoulders hunched with the shakes. Sammy Tigertail stopped the airboat and offered him hot coffee from a thermos.
"How about that picture you promised?" Wilson asked.
Sammy Tigertail patiently stood beside him as the man extended one arm, aiming the camera back at them. Sammy Tigertail was wearing a fleece zip-up from Patagonia, a woolen navy watch cap from L.L. Bean, and heavy khakis from Eddie Bauer, none of which would be considered traditional Seminole garb. Wilson asked Sammy Tigertail if he had one of those brightly beaded jackets and maybe a pair of deerskin moccasins. The Indian said no. Wilson instructed him not to smile and snapped a couple of pictures. Afterward, Sammy Tigertail cranked up the airboat and set out to finish the swamp tour at the highest possible speed. Because of the cold weather, there was practically no wildlife to be observed, but Wilson didn't seem to mind. Squinting against the wind, he gnawed a stick of dried beef and sipped on a warm Heineken. Sammy Tigertail took a shortcut through a prairie of tall sawgrass which flattened under the airboat's bow as neatly as wheat fields beneath a combine. Without warning, Wilson arose from his seat and dropped the beer bottle, spraying the deck. As Sammy Tigertail backed off the throttle, he saw Wilson begin to wobble and snatch at his own throat. Sammy Tigertail thought the man was gagging on a chunk of jerky, but in fact, he was trying to remove from his doughy neck a small banded water snake that had sailed out of the parting reeds. The creature was harmless, but evidently Wilson was in no condition to be surprised by a flying reptile. He dropped stone dead of a heart attack before his Seminole guide could get the boat stopped. The first thing that Sammy Tigertail did was lift the little snake off the lifeless tourist and release it into the marsh. Then he took out his cell phone and called his Uncle Tommy, who advised him to remove the dead white man from the reservation as soon as possible. In the absence of more specific instructions, Sammy Tigertail wrongly assumed that his uncle meant for him to dispose permanently of Wilson, not merely transport him to a neutral location. Sammy Tigertail feared that he would be held responsible for the tourist's death and that the tribal authorities wouldn't be able to protect him from the zeal of Collier County prosecutors, not one of whom was a Native American. So Sammy Tigertail ran the airboat back to the dock and carried Wilson's body to the rental car. No one was there to witness the transfer, but any neutral observer, especially one downwind of Wilson's boozy stink, would have concluded that he was a large, sloppy drunk who passed out on the swamp tour. Having positioned the corpse upright in the back seat, Sammy Tigertail drove directly to Everglades City, in the heart of the 10,000 Islands. There he purchased four anchors and borrowed a crab boat and headed for a snook hole he knew on the Lostman's River. Now a single coppery bubble marked the spot where the dead man had sunk. Sammy Tigertail stared into the turbid brown water, feeling gloomy and disgusted. It had been his first day working the airboat concession, and Wilson had been his first customer. His last, too. After returning the crab boat, he called his Uncle Tommy to say he was going away for a while. He said he wasn't spiritually equipped to deal with tourists.
"Boy, you can't hide from the white world," his uncle told him. I know, because I tried. At about the same time, in a trailer not far from the fishing docks, a boy named Fry looked up from his dinner plate and asked, "What is this crap?" It was not an unreasonable question.
"Salisbury steak," Honey Santana said. "It tastes better than it looks."
"Did you get fired again?"
"No, I quit," Honey said. "Now hush up and eat." As her son well knew, she resorted to frozen dinners only when she was out of work.
"What happened this time?"
he asked.
"You remember Aunt Rachel's chihuahua, Yum Yum Boy?
The one that got killed, right? Trying to hump a raccoon?"
"Yeah. Well, that's what Mr. Piejack is like," Honey said.
"Only bigger." She took a small bite of the tough gray meat. It was gruesome, but she managed to smile. Fry shrugged.
"So, did he make a move or what?"
"You could say that."
Mr. Piejack was the co-owner of the fish market, and he'd been sniffing after Honey for months. He was married and had numerous other unsavory qualities.
"You know those little wooden mallets we sell at the register?" Honey said.
Fry nodded. "For cracking stone crab claws."
"Right. That's what I whacked him with."
"Where?"
"Where do you think?"
As Fry pushed away from the table, Honey hurried to explain.
"He grabbed my breast. That's why I did it."
Her son looked up.
"For real? You're not making this up?"
"My right breast, I swear to God."
Honey solemnly entwined her hands over the object of Mr. Piejack's lust.
"What an a-hole,"
Fry said.
"Totally. After I hit him, he started rolling on the floor, moaning and whining. So I grabbed a slab of tuna out of the cooler and shoved it down his pants, you know, to keep the swelling down."
"What kind of tuna?"
"Yellowfin," Honey said. "Sushi grade." Fry grinned.
"He'll throw it back on the ice and sell it to some snowbird."
"That's gross," Honey said.
"How much you want to bet?" "Hey, I could fix us some soup."
She got up and scraped the Salisbury steaks into the garbage can.
"Minestrone or cream of tomato?"
"Whatever." Fry scooted his chair back to the table. Sometimes he believed that his mother was on the verge of losing her mind, and sometimes he believed that she was the sanest person he'd ever met.
"Now what, Mom?"
"You know my friend Bonnie? She's doing these eco tours where she takes tourists kayaking out to Cormorant Key," Honey said. "She says it's a ton of fun and the money's pretty good, too. Anyway, driving home from Marco this afternoon, I noticed a string of bright yellow kayaks crossing the bay, and I thought, what a heavenly way to spend the day, paddling in the sunshine through the mangroves."
"Kayaks?"
Fry said skeptically.
"Is this the same Bonnie with the solar-powered sewing machine?"
"You sound like your ex-father."
"He's not my ex-father, he's your ex-husband. Anyway, what did I say wrong?"
"Oh, just the look on your face."
"How much does a kayak cost?"
Honey set two bowls on the table.
"I'm not sure, but we'll need at least two or three for starters."
"And where would you take these goobers on your eco tour?"
Fry asked.
"I mean, since Bonnie's already locked up Cormorant Key."
Honey laughed.
"Have you looked out your window lately? Have you noticed all those gorgeous green islands?"
The phone began to ring. Honey frowned.
"Every night," she said, "like clockwork." "Then don't answer it,"
her son said.
"No, I've had it with these clowns. Enough is enough."
More than 1,000 miles away, a man named Boyd Shreave stirred a latte and listened on his wireless headset to a phone ringing somewhere distant, in the 239 area code. A photocopied script lay on the desktop in front of him. But Boyd Shreave no longer needed it. After 3 days, he knew the pitch cold. Shreave was employed by Relentless, Inc., a telemarketing company that specialized in outbound sales calls to middle-income residential addresses in the United States. The firm's call center was a converted B-52 hangar in Fort Worth, Texas, where Boyd Shreave and 53 other solicitors toiled in individual cubicles that were padded to dampen ambient noise. In the cubicle to the right of Boyd Shreave was a woman named Eugenie Fonda, who claimed a murky connection to the famous acting family, and in any case had recently become Boyd Shreve's mistress.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.